Today marks the beginning of Advent, a season of preparation and anticipation that the Christian Church has celebrated for about 1,400 years. Since the middle of the 6th century AD, Christians have started preparing to celebrate Christ's birth on a Sunday closest to November 30th, the Feast of Andrew the Apostle, on the liturgical calendar. Traditionally, this is also the beginning of the church year. The first candle of the Advent wreath is called the Candle of Prophecy, or the Hope Candle. It reminds us of how God spoke to his people through the prophets, offering them the hope of the Savior. It also reminds us of the faithfulness of God's promises, so that we can live in hope.
If you'll take your worship bulletin and follow along, we're going to read responsibly the declaration of our purpose here this morning. This morning, we come together to prepare for the birthday of the King. We begin this special and holy season in a spirit of love and unity. Let us clear our minds and open our hearts to the coming of the King.
Let us honor his birth.
Let our songs and symbols represent the reality of our personal devotion and dedication to the Lord.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Almighty God, as we gather together, we are thrilled that so many have come to worship here today. And already we can sense the presence of your Spirit moving among us. We invite you, O Lord. We ask for your presence humbly, and we're grateful that you are here. We ask that you'd help us as we worship you today in a different way, but in a way that has meaning and that will allow us to begin the season of Advent, a season of preparation in which we look forward to celebrating the coming of the Christ child. Bless all who have gathered here today, Father, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you would, take a hymnal and turn to hymn number 205. Hymn number 205. Just the first verse together.
The first
come and behold.
psalmist has written, God is our refuge and strength, as ever present help in trouble. Isaiah prophesied, in that day the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for the peoples. The nations will rally to him, and his place of rest will be glorious. Moses called God Jehovah Nissi, a Hebrew phrase which means, the Lord is my banner. This year we place a banner to remind us that long before there was a Christmas, an Advent season of preparation for a church, God was our banner, going before us and preparing for the establishment of his people.
The use of colors to differentiate the liturgical seasons became a common practice in the Western Church in about the 4th century. At first, usages varied considerably, but by the 12th century, purple, white, black, red, and green became standardized. The colors express emotions and ideas that are associated with each of the seasons of the liturgical year. During Advent, we decorate the pulpit, lectern, and communion table with purple because it is a symbol of the sovereignty of Christ and repentance from sin.
Verse 2.
As we begin the Christian year, we also celebrate the holy season known as Advent. It is a time when we prepare ourselves for the coming of our Messiah. Advent means coming. We celebrate these days of Advent in expectation and preparation for Christ's arrival. Through the centuries, Christians have observed the time of waiting and expectation before celebrating the birth of the Savior at Christmas. The Advent season is a time for reflection and preparation, but its mood is joyful. Advent has been enriched by Christian tradition to reflect its distinctive Christian meaning. It proclaims the revelation of God's love as expressed in Christ's birth in a humble stable, his sacrificial death on the cross, and his victorious resurrection. It points to the hope of Christ coming again as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Advent makes innkeepers out of all of us, asking each of us to make room for the arrival of Christ the King. Let us today prepare him room in our hearts, our lives, and our homes.
Verse 3.
Sing, choirs of angels, sing in exaltation. Oh, sing on, we citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, glory in the
chose to send his son into our world as a baby to humble birth. Born in common surroundings, we do not know. What we do know is that God reached out to all people, including the poor and wealthy and simple and the wise, the powerless and the powerful. All who found him knelt in humility before him, knowing God is possible because he came to us at our level. Whenever we see a nativity, we find ourselves with Mary and Joseph, with the shepherds and with the wise men, bowing before the manger, overwhelmed by God's expression of love in coming to us. We place a nativity this year to remind us that wise men and women still seek the Christ child. Great joy for all the
that will, for all the people today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you, and he is the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You finally wreck the baby in Jesus' bosom.
Number 191. First and the third verses.
Two times.
most universal feature of Christmas is the use of evergreens in churches and homes. Among ancient Romans, evergreens were an emblem of peace, joy, and victory. The early Christmas placed them in their windows to indicate that Christ had entered the home. Pine, fir, and spruce are called evergreens because they never change color. They are evergreen, ever alive, even in the midst of winter. They symbolize the unchanging nature of our God, and they remind us of the everlasting life that is ours through Christ Jesus. Our forefathers called the gathering of these evergreens bringing home Christmas. In Isaiah 60:13, we find these words: "The glory of Lebanon shall come unto you, the fir tree, the pine tree, and the box together, to beautify the place of your sanctuary."
Fourth verse of hymn 188.
Thank you.
Today, the Christmas tree is the center of our festivities. Glittering with lights and ornaments, it is part of the beauty and meaning of Christmas. There are several legends and stories about the Christmas tree. The first use of the Christmas tree was in the medieval German paradise plays held outdoors and portraying the creation of humankind. The tree of life was a fir tree decorated with apples. Later, other ornaments were hung upon them, such as paper flowers and gilded knots. In England, branches or whole trees were forced into bloom indoors for Christmas. From these beginnings, the use of a tree at Christmas was established. Martin Luther was perhaps the first to use a lighted tree.
The story is told that on one Christmas Eve, Martin Luther wandered outdoors and became enraptured with the beauty of the starry sky. Its brilliance and loveliness led him to reflect on the glory of the first Christmas Eve, as seen in Bethlehem's radiant skies. Wishing to share with his wife and children the enchantment he had felt, he cut from the forest an evergreen glistening with snow and took it home. He placed upon it candles to represent the glorious heavens he had seen. The use of a candle-lighted tree spread to all Europe. Then America came to regard it as the central ornament of Christmas. As we sing together, everyone is invited to come forward and place an ornament on the tree. If you brought one from home, you are welcome to use it at this time. If not, there are some provided in the front. Please come at this time and decorate our tree.
Hymn number 194, and let's all stand together.
Thank you.
Fantastic. If our ushers will come at this time, you may be seated. Join me in prayer. Almighty God, it is our great privilege to worship you and to participate in your kingdom. And you have blessed us richly and in abundance. And now, Lord, we pray that you would bless us as we obey you in our tithes and offer that which you have provided for us above and beyond our time. Thank you for all that you give us, Lord, and for the privilege of being part of this. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The term angel is derived from the Greek word angelos, which means messenger. Angelos and the Hebrew equivalent, malek, which also means messenger, are the two most common terms used to describe this class of beings in the Bible. In general, in texts where an angel appears, the task of the angel is to convey the messenger or do the will of God who sent him. Since the focus of the text is on the message, the messenger is rarely described in detail. The angel's function as a messenger or agent of God is acted out in proclamation, revealing the will of God and or announcing key events. An angel announced to Joseph that Mary would have a child. Mary received a special messenger who told her that she would have a son and named him Jesus because he would save the people from their sins. Tonight we celebrate angels as the bearers of good news.
Number 206. The first and the third verses.
Yeah.
us do not realize the origin of the candy cane and its symbolism. A candy maker in Indiana wanted to make a special kind of candy that would tell the story of Christmas. He decided to begin with a stick of pure white hard candy. The white would symbolize Jesus' birth from a virgin and his sinless life. He made it hard to let us know that Jesus is the solid rock and to symbolize the firm promises of God. Next, he bent it into the form of a J to stand for Jesus. Turned upside down, it looks like a shepherd's staff, reminding us that Jesus is the good shepherd. Finally, he decided to put stripes on it to remind us that Jesus suffered and died for us. Stripes to represent the scourging of Jesus received before his death, and one thick one to represent the blood that he shed for us on the cross. Every true candy cane will have these symbols on them, reminding us that Jesus is our Lord and Savior, who came to earth so that we could be with our Heavenly Father forever.
The birth of Jesus and the life he lived brought many changes to the world. The life he lived, the truths he taught, the example he gave, the love he generated, his life, his teachings, his truth. These are the guideposts for all of life. We often symbolize these truths with light. Candles symbolize the life Jesus lived, the example he gave, the wholeness of his life, words, and deeds. The flame of our candles remind us of his teachings, the truths he shared, the parables he told, the wisdom he gave.
I want to be one on the floor.
Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. You are the light of the world. A city of a hill on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven.
Considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted.
But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth.
In the midst of all the joy that is Christmas, and I assure you that I am the biggest kid in this room when it comes to Christmas, and the celebration, and the gifts, and the giving, and the songs, and Santa, and everything else that goes along with it. But of course we are to be reminded that at Christmas we celebrate the birth of the Christ child. Whether or not it actually occurred on that date historically is totally irrelevant. The fact that it occurred is a matter of hand. And you are now receiving one for each household, a common male. It's not intended to be a decoration. We purposely did not hang ribbons on it or paint it a pretty color. It is intended to be unattractive. It is intended to be large and intimidating, and please be careful, it's intended to be sharp. It reminds us that the Christ child that we celebrate throughout the Christmas season is our Lord and Savior, who traveled from the creche to the cross, who went from Bethlehem to Golgotha, and suffered and died so that we could have a remission of our sins. So in the midst of all our celebration, I'd like to introduce you to a custom that perhaps you're not used to, that our family has used for many, many years. Because this is not a decoration, it's not hung on your tree in the same way as everything else. In fact, this is to be hung with just you and your family. And it goes on the tree up close to the trunk, just up where you and your family know where it is. And it's placed there as a reminder of what Christmas truly is and what Jesus did for all of us. God bless you. Be sure you get one of those. Take over your family. And now let's all read together.
I got something on.
To the Prince of Peace, we now dedicate these symbols of the Nativity, the Advent season, and our Christian faith. O God, we now dedicate our lives anew to the service of Christ and pray that we may be filled with your love, so perfectly revealed through the birth and life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Pray with me. Father, how grateful we are to worship you. And what a wonderful opportunity it brings. We're grateful, especially, Lord, for this season of the year. And as we begin Advent, our minds turn toward Christmas, when we will celebrate your birth with friends and family, and we will exchange gifts, and we put tremendous meaning in these symbols. And so, Lord, today we've brought these symbols into the sanctuary where we worship you. They remind us of you. They remind us of your love and your grace, and they remind us of your birth and your life and your death and your resurrection. And so we dedicate them, Lord, in such a way that they would be a reminder to all who enter this sanctuary during the Advent season that you are, in fact, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and it is you that we celebrate. Amen. Now would you stand with me And I'm going to call my helper. Got a very special job to take place here. We're going to count it down. Are you ready down there? Request, we're going to sing all the verses of Silent Night, hymn number 189.
Joy to the world, the Lord is. joy.